Hello and welcome to Crosstalk, where all things are considered. I'm Peter Laveau. The elusive search for justice. Is the citizens' arrest campaign to have Tony Blair held accountable for possible war crimes and other serious offenses a public relations stunt? Or is it an important precedent for those leaders who start wars of aggression? If you had a chance, would you arrest Blair? To crosstalk whether Tony Blair should be put on trial, I'm joined by Stephen Schlesinger in New York. He is a senior fellow at the Century Foundation and author of the book Act of Creation. And in Washington, we cross to Ivan Eland. He is a senior fellow and director of the Center on Peace and Liberty at the Independent Institute. All right, gentlemen, crosstalk rules in effect. That means you can jump in anytime you want, and I very much encourage it. Stephen, did Tony Blair commit a crime in 2003 with the invasion of Iraq?
Well, it's a decision I disagreed with, but he committed a policy error. He didn't commit a crime. Now, I think it's important to make a distinction between what happens in a democracy and what happens in a dictatorship. In a democracy, when you make a policy mistake, you pay for it in different ways, whether it's public opinion or ostracism or in the history books. That is not true in a dictatorship. And I think that's the distinction that should be ruling in this case.
Okay. Ivan Eland, what do you think about that? So no crime was committed with the invasion of Iraq?
Well, I think they violated the UN Charter on the sovereignty of nations. And Blair was certainly a co-conspirator with Bush on that. It was a severe policy error. And I think we ought to start holding people accountable when they invade countries for no reason. I mean, how is that different than the Soviet Union invading Czechoslovakia in 1968 or Hungary in 1956? We have a double standard in the U.S. And, of course, you know, there's other aspects. What did he have to do with the torture that the Bush administration had? Were the British involved in that? There are other questions that could be asked. So I'm not sure I don't think it'll happen, because the way the world is set up is we prosecute developing leaders or rebels for war crimes, but we can't do it for major powers because they have too much power in the system. So I don't think it'll happen. The question is, should they be? I don't think it's out of the realm of possibility that they probably morally and legally could be.
Stephen, okay, weigh in on that. Just because they're powerful, they can avoid the law.
Well, no, I totally agree with the other commentator, which is that what happened in Iraq was a violation of the UN Charter. The UN never gave its sanction to that invasion.
The law was broken. International law was broken. Yes.
This is true. But you know, I have to say that I've done a book on the UN. The UN Charter has been violated many times by both sides, on the communist side and the democratic side. The U.S. went into Kosovo without the sanction of the UN Security Council. So there are, you know, the question is where. There's two questions. One, is the violation such that it becomes a war crime? And the second question is, how do you draw the line about war crimes? When Franklin Roosevelt didn't rescue the Jews in the Second World War, is that a war crime? When Obama is not intervening in Syria, is that a war crime? I mean, it's a very, very
But Stephen, we're talking about
define.
The violation of international
Hopefully,
law.
The International Criminal Court.
We're looking at law, established
hopefully,
law.
The International Criminal Court will eventually be the arbiter of these kind of issues. But this is something that is going to take some time to make clear how you define it.
Ivan Eland, how you define it? What's defined?
Well, I think we often in the United States define terrorism and war crimes and all this other stuff to alleviate our own government of some blame. Of course, in the terror bombings in World War II, we always kind of forget about those. But nations can commit acts of terrorism and, in fact, have killed more people with terrorist acts against civilians than little rebel groups like even al-Qaeda around. And so I think nation states are not, especially powerful nation states, are never held to these types of things because they're the pillars of the international system. I guess that's what people think. They're just simply too powerful to prosecute. But if you do want to institute an international legal system and you want to have the International Criminal Court as its basis, which of course the United States doesn't, it's supporting it more now behind the scenes, but it hasn't joined and doesn't intend to join it. So it's very difficult to use that forum to get at people. But I mean, George Bush's invasion of Iraq was such a flagrant violation of not only international law, but international custom of any, you would define it as aggression if you had an impartial look at it. Almost any person or any country other than the United States, of course, would say it's aggression.
And Britain.
Right, and Britain as well, right. And Britain was all the way our lackey, if you will, in the whole mess. And so I think I'm sure you could probably implicate Blair for some of the help with the CIA secret prisons and that sort of thing, although it's not been established. But I mean, the Brits were really close to the U.S. on policy on torture and that sort of thing as well, I think, in Iraq and elsewhere. I think that should be explored.
Stephen, jump in. Go ahead.
It's important to note that in both cases of Blair and George W. Bush, They've in a sense been ostracized by the public. I mean, George W. Bush couldn't even show up at the last Republican convention. He's so tarnished by what he did in his term in office, particularly in Iraq. Blair has been rejected by his own party. It's not as if these people have not been, in a sense, punished. It's not in a court situation, but in the arena of public opinion. Now, it is. You are right, though, to point out that power realities do play a role in this kind of world arena. You know, when the UN was set up in 1945, five countries were given the veto power. Now, none of the rest of the members of the UN have that veto power. Now, why were they given that veto power in 1945? Because they were considered the most powerful countries on Earth at that time. And they were also considered the people, the states that were most likely to give support in terms of troops and financing to any UN action. Well, of course, today, the power realities are much different in the year 2013. And it's been a constant problem within the UN, where many states feel that the Security Council composition should be changed and the veto should be dropped or it should be expanded. But the fact is, as the other commentator points out, power realities do play an enormous role in defining what is considered a war crime or what isn't considered a war crime. And we do have to recognize that even as we pursue the ideal, which is to have an international criminal court be the arbiter of these kind of situations.
Do we need law then, international law, if no one's going to be held accountable?
Well, I think it would help. The problem that you have with the International Criminal Court is in a situation in Assad, a hot conflict, is if these dictators think that they're going to be thrown up before the court and thrown in jail for the rest of their lives, they're going to fight more. So there are downsides to the International Court, but I think there are also upsides. But of course, here's what happened. The Britain and the U.S. Invaded Iraq, and even killing rebels, what we would call some terrorists, that was unnecessary. So anyone who died in that war died unnecessarily because it was aggression, right? So Bush and Blair killed probably hundreds of thousands of people. We don't know. They didn't bother to keep track of how many civilians were killed or Iraqis were killed in that war. And so, you call it a war crime, you call it aggression, whatever you call it. You have Milosevic in the dock for killing far fewer people. you know, so is that fair? Probably not, but that's the reality. But I think, you know, we should develop some international standards for these things, but of course, and try to enforce them. But of course, you reach roadblocks when powerful nations are brought to the dock, so to speak, and their leaders are brought into the dock.
So, Stephen, international law is for the weak, not for the powerful. Stephen.
Well, actually, you know, international law is something in process. It's always being developed. It's not something that has ever reached the ideal because, as we've pointed out, the power realities are such around the world that you cannot ever get to the best situation that you want in terms of punishment for war crimes. But the creation of the United Nations has been an important development in the affirmation of international law. There have been over 300 treaties so far which have been have occurred because of UN auspices. And, you know, it's not just in war crimes. It's, you know, the maritime law, airplane safety, all sorts of issues that cross borders that have to be dealt with on a world scale. So international law is something that we are always trying to achieve. We never quite reach the best of what we want to achieve, but it is there to remind people that there is a moral and legal issue that always has to be taken into consideration when big issues occur. Now, war crimes is again one of these issues that is still being developed, and it is quite true that it's dictators more than Democrats that get punished, at least as far as the International Criminal Court is concerned. But I do think that.
All right, Stephen, I'm going to jump in here. I'll let you finish. We're going to go to a short break, and after that short break, we'll continue our discussion on trying Tony Blair. Stay with RT.
I love it.
In his secret laboratory, Tim Kirby was able to build the world's most sophisticated robot, which unfortunately doesn't give a darn about anything. Tim's mission? To teach his creation why it should care about humans and world events. This is Why You Should Care. Watch only on RT.com.
This land, torn apart by conflict and war, has changed. A modern Islamic nation. And a peaceful one.
Islam is first, of course. Secular law second.
With fashion and tourism. In place of bombs and guns. Where old traditions still count.
A model cannot go on the catwalk in a swimsuit.
Allahu Akbar!
Chechnya, a republic of contrasts, on RT.
Wealthy British scion Zach Wilson. Investment activist.
Markets, finance, scandal. Find out what's really happening to the global economy with Max Kaiser for a no-holds-barred look at the global financial headlines. Tune in to Kaiser Report on RT.
Готово.
International Airport, in the very heart of Moscow.
Welcome back to Crosstalk, where all things are considered. I'm Peter Lavelle. To remind you, we're discussing whether Tony Blair should be put on trial. Ivan, do you think Tony Blair will ever face any consequences, legal consequences, for what he did?
I would say probably not, given the current power realities. And I think that it's very interesting. Another example of this power reality is simply the movement to get Blair instead of Bush. I mean, certainly Britain is on the Security Council and has nuclear weapons and that sort of thing, but it's a medium power nowadays, and the U.S. is a superpower. And so it's interesting that they're going after Blair and not Bush, because, of course, Bush had much more blatant policies of torture, and he was the impetus behind the invasion. I think Tony Blair was initially reluctant to do it, and then he gradually knew that if Britain wanted to have its special relationship with the U.S. continue, it needed to go along with whatever Bush wanted to do. But the movement here is against Blair and not Bush, and that's an indicator of the current state of affairs. So I would say probably even Blair will not face prosecution, simply because he's perceived as being a leader of a democratic country, or he was a leader of a democratic country, as opposed to a dictator. But the problem that we have in international affairs is that sometimes autocracies are not aggressive, and sometimes democracies are very aggressive. The British, French empires, the U.S. informal empire that it has now. I'd say the U.S. is probably the most aggressive country in the world, including the Soviet Union, after World War II. If you look at the data, I don't think there's any question about the amount of military intervention that's gone on. But as we've been saying, these countries are powerful. They're perceived as being democratic leaders, which makes them seem more benevolent somehow when their external behavior may not be.
Stephen, would you like to reply to that? That's very interesting.
Yeah, well, actually, if you're making the point about the U.S. being aggressive after 1945, if you look back at history, the U.S. was incredibly aggressive before 1945. It was intervening all over Latin America for a century. And, of course, there was no rules or regulations at that time, so nobody...
But there are rules and regulations today.
...standard during that period.
It is different today.
But since 1945, since the creation of the United Nations and since the formulation of all sorts of treaties, no, I think there's no question today that there are standards that countries have to abide by. And frankly, one of the reasons that a country would want to abide by them is that in order to be a member of an organization like the United Nations, there are standards that they have to meet to be a regular participant in that place. Now, of course, it's very unlikely that a country will be ousted from the UN. It's really never happened. except with, you know, South Africa. But on the other hand, the moral persuasion of an international body like the UN can have a terrific impact, as well as international law, terrific impact on decision-making in countries, whether they're democracies or dictatorships. And I will say one last point. Even a democratic leader like Henry Kissinger, an appointed leader as opposed to an elected leader, cannot go to certain countries because of fear of prosecution.
Do you think that should apply to Blair? Should that apply to Blair, in your opinion, Stephen?
Well, I think there's something to be said that Blair should be at least considered a person of interest of that sort, but I doubt it's ever going to happen.
Ivan, what do you think? That's one way to get
him. I think it may happen. Certainly, Kissinger was guilty of helping Nixon to carpet bomb hundreds of thousands of people. So Kissinger may be a bit more flagrant violator, but certainly, if this goes forward, they may have some inroads. I agree with Stephen that it probably won't happen, but I think you can. You can make it happen, and like Kissinger, sort of him livery of going overseas and that sort of thing. But my question is, what about Bush? So he was the real driver of the war, et cetera. And I was only using the post-World War II period to compare this with really the Soviet period of, after World War II. I agree that the U.S. was aggressive in Latin America prior to that.
You know, Stephen, would you like to hear Blair apologize? At least that. And Bush, too.
Yes, I would like to hear Blair apologize. I think he owes that not just to his own country, but to the world.
Well, how about to the Iraqi people? And to the Iraqi people as well.
And to the Iraqi people, of course, absolutely. That in fact, should be the first place that he should apologize. But I think the point is that, you know, Blair has sort of recreated a new career for himself as a kind of roving ambassador to help settle the Middle Eastern situation. He's not been a terribly significant player in that role, but he's redeemed himself to that extent so that people don't focus solely on what he did in Iraq. It is interesting that people do have careers after abysmal failures in their past, and it's something that I kind of regret in Blair's role, because I think he did not pay for what he did, and I do think that by going along with Bush as he did, he really dragged the British people into an affair that they will regret for many years to come.
Ivan, redemption. Any redemption for Bush, Blair?
Well, I think Stephen is right in the fact that that's probably going to help Blair maybe avoid this, because, you know, people, a popular opinion around the world and does matter in these affairs. It's not really supposed to. The facts are supposed to matter. But I think people's image or whatever, and I think Blair is attempting to clean up his image and have some redemption, at least in the public mind, for this. So, you know, whereas Bush is sitting at his ranch, staying out of sight, Blair is actively, you know, becoming a peacemaker. So we look back at Teddy Roosevelt. He was always very belligerent in rhetoric and manner, but, you know, he helped end the 1905 war between Russia and Japan. And so he that kind of softened his image. And I think, we're not talking about Teddy Roosevelt being on trial for war crimes, but I think that sort of thing does help your image, and it probably will help Blair avoid these things.
Stephen, have we learned anything, these two gentlemen?
Well, we've learned that democracies can make mistakes. You know, we can elect leaders.
Yeah, but do democracies pay the price? Do they pay the price? Do they pay the price?
Certainly they pay the price. The U.S. society has paid an enormous price for what Bush did.
Well, what about the political class? Have they paid?
Yeah. Well, the political class paid it too. I mean, Bush not only destroyed the U.S. in terms of these wars that he fought in Iraq and earlier in Afghanistan, but also in terms of the U.S. economy. And we, as a result of his incredible errors, we have just gone through the worst recession since the Great Depression. So, yes, democratic societies do pay for the mistakes of their leaders.
Ivan Eland, what do you think?
Well, I think Obama can't be exempted from blame here. He came in and he just kind of swept all the Bush era under the rug with the torture, with the Iraq War. He just wanted to put that all in the past because he didn't want it to interfere with his agenda. But to me, in a democracy and a republic as we're supposed to have, it's vitally important when somebody flagrantly violates international law as well as domestic laws against torture that and other things and unconstitutional wars, you know, you really need to look into it. And I think that, you know, Obama kind of swept that under the rug because I think he's afraid of somebody doing that to him. The next Republicans will get at him, you know, if they get into office next. And I think that's the way it works in democracy. There's sort of a collusion between the two parties. Well, we're not going to dredge up your old skeletons if you don't do it to us. So I think that was that was terrible. And I think we would have found out more about Tony Blair's role had Obama looked into the Bush thing, because Tony Blair was Bush's sidekick through the whole thing.
Stephen, what do you think about that? That's interesting.
Well, I agree. I think that's a blemish on Obama's record, that he did not open an investigation of what happened on the torture issue. Fortunately, we do have a free press, and they've done a lot of investigation on their own and brought out a lot of these details that otherwise would have been buried. And I think that's the one saving grace in a democracy, that you do have a kind of investigative capacity, not just, by the way, in the press, but also in Congress, to reopen old wounds and find out what happened to cause them. And I think that certainly the country has learned that the Bush administration did permit torture to go on. And the reputations of people like Cheney and Rumsfeld have been incredibly blackened by what happened, as well as, of course, George W. Bush. So there is some redeeming value in a free-wheeling democracy that this stuff comes out. It's unfortunate that in the case of Obama, we did not learn more of the details in a kind of investigation which was sponsored by the government itself. But listen, more stuff will probably come out.
I bet. Yep.
At least we do know what happened pretty much to detail.
All right, gentlemen, fascinating discussion. Many thanks to my guests in Washington and in New York. And thanks to our viewers for watching us here at RT. See you next time. And remember, Crosstalk rules.
I'm seeing.
I love it.